Random House Audio presents French Women for All Seasons, a year of secrets, recipes, and pleasures. This is the author, Mireille Guiliano. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Thus, Charles Dickens began his tale of two cities a century and a half ago. The cities he imagined were Paris and London. The countries he was contrasting were revolutionary France and late 18th century England. Two opposing worlds, two points of view, and two divergent destinies. When I wrote French Women Don't Get Fat, I had in mind two disparate worlds of eating, the French and the American. Also, to a lesser extent, two cities, Paris and New York. What I didn't realize at the time was that I was in fact writing a tale of two global cultures, increasingly without borders. For better and worse, where you live no longer dictates how you eat. It's up to you. Even in our ever more complex world, it is still possible to have our cake and eat it too, to enjoy our days to the fullest, while embracing a time-tested, back-to-basics approach to life. One filled with quality, sensitivity, seasonal foods, and pleasure. I don't want to live in the past, but I do want to learn from it. And I believe that the culture of moderation, painstaking attention to taste, and healthy eating and living that I absorbed growing up in France can be adapted to today's world and pursued just about anywhere. This is not to say I don't understand or appreciate firsthand the challenges women these days face. The pressures of too much to do in too little time, of mega portions, and industrially produced food often eaten on the run. Last fall, a French reporter followed me through the Union Square Green Market in New York, where we encountered a class of 8-year-olds with their teacher. The kids were participating in a program called Spoons Across America, a not-for-profit organization dedicated to educating children, teachers, and families about the benefits of healthy eating and the value of supporting local farmers and sharing meals around the family table. As it was fall, apples of many varieties were abundantly available. But when the reporter, half kidding, picked one up and asked the little boy what it was, the child drew a blank. Forget the variety. He didn't know it was an apple. This city kid had apparently never seen one in real life. It gives one pause. I would bet, though, that he could recognize the packaged apple pie at the McDonald's just opposite the Green Market. The world where I grew up and my experience of apples in Alsace-Lorraine could not have been farther from this little boy's in New York City. We had numerous apple trees in our garden. Come apple picking time, my job was to place the different varieties we grew into little flat crates called cagettes, which we put into the cold cellar for winter storage, a centuries-old practice now mostly gone. What sweet and glorious aromas filled that cellar when I deposited all those baskets. And of course, the harvest meant my mother would once again make an apple pie, une tarte aux pommes alsacienne. In our garden, we also had bushes of groseille, tart red currants that are a regional specialty. My mother and I love to make pies with these tiny berries. The season for red currants is short, and oh, how we looked forward to this once-a-year treat, which somehow exemplifies for me the French woman's psychological pleasure in food. It's the anticipation and joy that we gain from a pleasure we cannot take for granted and know we will soon lose. Tasting such seasonal bounty heightens our awareness of what we put into our mouth and contrasts with routine, mindless eating that provides little pleasure and often unwanted pounds. These days, an image I carry around with me is of two airports. At O'Hare International in Chicago, people all around me in the terminal were gulping down hamburgers, fries, and pizza, and knocking back big tubs of soda or coffee as they tapped away on their laptops, talked on their cell phones, and flipped through newspapers. Most remarkable, it was 10 a.m. Why were they even eating? I asked myself. Breakfast? Early lunch? Or just a way to pass the time? And most of the people I saw were significantly overweight. Plus, I could not detect pleasure on a single face. The airport cum food court may be a sign of the times, but not quite yet in France. At Charles de Gaulle, or Roissy as the French call it, when French people eat, they still generally sit down with a knife and fork at enclosed cafeterias or restaurants. There are small stand-up bars for those who want a quick croissant and a cup of coffee, but have you seen a typical French cup of coffee? 3 sips, 4 max, no frappuccino gargantuoso con latteria, or whatever. Things in France are not yet set up to accommodate the contemporary culture of excess. But in the art corner, you do find people engaging in alien habits, with 2 sandwiches, an iPod, and a magazine feeding them all at once. But in France, they are the exception. In America, they rule. Ever since that day in Chicago, whenever I see such scenes, I think of a quote by Brillat Savarin, the 18th century modern gastronome, well known for his writings and meditations on the physiology of taste, and for his famous dictum, "We are what we eat." But he also wrote even more revealingly, "The destiny of a nation depends on how it feeds itself." Even Paris, famed as the world capital of slender women, is not immune to the growing culture of excess and the global breakdown in traditional ways of eating. Fast food chains arrived years ago on the Boulevard Saint-Germain and the Champs-Élysées. French women are not immune to the primal urges for the sweet and salty that make fast food appealing. But even more important, they are not exempt from the pressures of living and working in a globalized world that erodes traditional local values and speeds up the pace of life, leaving less time for savoring food as our parents did. As eating becomes less and less a family affair, mothers and fathers neglect to teach their children the right way to eat. Bad habits rush to fill the void. There's even a public service ad campaign in France with the slogan, "Obésité tue," obesity kills. Make no mistake, overeating is an approaching global epidemic. Unless we get our act together, in one generation, the French will be as dangerously overweight as many Americans and other nationalities. Long ago, I made the connection that a serious interest in food, this pillar of the French lifestyle, is the main reason that, overwhelmingly and by tradition, French women don't get fat. My first book was addressed to the untold legions of diet victims whom I urged to reject the twin hoaxes of 1, deprivation is the key to weight loss, and 2, indulgence is to blame for weight gain. Pleasure has proved to be the most powerful and lasting motivation, even more compelling than the dream of dropping a dress size. Actually, it was just common sense reborn. If we can all harness the pleasure principle, we can lose weight, as French women have done for generations. All we need is to learn a sense of proportion and cultivate our appreciation of taste. Do that and we should never feel deprived. I asked for a commitment of months, not weeks, but the promise in return was results that last. I'm hardly a champion of France in all things, just in some. And it's not out of some precious snobbery that I reject many of the things on supermarket shelves. When foods are bursting with natural taste, as opposed to being artificially flavored, laden with fat and salt, or just plain tasteless, the experience of eating them is more satisfying, and we can content ourselves with less. And so, when French women exult over some perfectly ripe melon, they are making a spectacle not just of themselves, but of their capacity to register real degrees of difference, a talent nurtured by a culture in which things are harvested in season and bought fresh. This capacity, more than anything else, is their secret weapon in not getting fat. The pleasure of quality.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.